So, Joseph, thank you very much for joining me on this series, Exploring the Future of Western Civilization. And I've been fascinated to meet you, knowing your incredible history, your journey through American politics from conservative all the way through to a transpartisan leader. And I really love it if you'd be able to share with anyone that doesn't know you just basically a brief summary of what brought you along and what brought you to where you are now.
So where I am now is something of a catalyst, I guess I would call myself. Not necessarily a leader, because there is something of a movement of movements that are happening. But I always wasn't a uniter. I was very much a divider, and that my political career started in that realm. This started in the place of hyperpolarization, a lot of hatred of enemies. And I took my military and my business and my conservative tendencies, which had kind of the warrior kind of aspect to them, and I focused them on defeating. And I found that when I attacked, I got attacked. And over a period of time later in my political career, then I suffered the results of the abuses that I had done to others were done to me. And so I reflected, I stepped away from it all, and I reflected for a couple years in a deep way, out through the pain of the wounds that I had self-inflicted in a lot of ways through relationships and mistrust. And then I decided to go back into politics in 2003, 2004. Figuring out practically, not idealistically or ideally, but practically, how do we reunite America was the model that I was using. How do you reunite these polarities? And come to find out in doing the work for 8 years now, it's really applicable within organizations, it's applicable within any political system.
I imagine lots of people listening won't necessarily have heard of transpartisan politics. Would you be able to summarize it so as to make it sound juicy and exciting?
So it is a way of engaging in politics that moves beyond traditional polarities, and it seeks to integrate all points of view, left, right, center, powerful and powerless, those who are insiders and those who are outsiders, using models of organizational development and alternative dispute resolution, essentially dialogue processes, where people sit together as equals. You have decision makers sitting as equals with people that tend to be on the outside of most political decisions. And when you build those types of groups, then you generate a collective intelligence which can deal with complexity. And right now our political system is designed in a way where it's an operating system, kind of like a computer operating system, that literally cannot deal with complexity. It can deal with simplicity, it can deal with complicated problems, but when you get to complexity, it defaults in some ways, which is pretty much what we're seeing at the systemic level. Only when you have a transpartisan political process can you actually integrate enough points of view to achieve the wisdom needed to create policy solutions that work for vast majorities of people.
So if I understand right, the idea is it's going beyond the old divisions of left and right, Republican and Democrat, conservative and Labour, and also at quite a deep level, you're talking about integrating masculine and feminine, mind and heart, and so on. One thing I did wonder in reading through your story was, what's the difference between where you are as a transpartisan person and someone who's just a Republican that became a liberal?
Ah, great question.
Because after
So I
all,
have.
a liberal would say that they were pluralistic, open to different perspectives. I mean, they aren't necessarily, but sensitive, aware, wanting to draw lots of diverse opinions in for the purpose of inclusivity and complexity. So how is it that you are different from that?
So I still feel very rooted in the conservative movement. I still feel those values very strongly, and they come from my heart. Their discipline, their responsibility, hard work, the protection of the individual, the defense of our nation. Those are I'm a former military officer. I'm a former Army Ranger, which is has the equivalents in the British system. And these are people that identify. They have their identity is about protection and conservation and tradition and heritage. And I was raised that way, and that's who I am. Now, I didn't throw that away. I actually used that as a foundation to grow and then open through my own personal crisis to a whole other set of values, which were nurturing and compassion and community. I hated the word community. Community meant communism. It meant that you didn't love your country. And I grew up at a time when Vietnam was an issue and these hippies that didn't love their country, they were my identified enemy. And when I actually lived with hippies for a couple years, I mean, I'm talking real tie-dyed, barefoot, dope-smoking hippies, and I looked deeper at their values, and I said, wow, these people don't care my last name. They don't care my resume. They want to have a relationship. They want to mutually support each other, and they exchanged in the most amazing ways beyond currency. In other words, they had ways, and this was a communitarian way of life that actually was very deeply rooted in the heritage of our country that we had lost. And so as I kind of evaluated, I said, wow, that's just a softer set of values, and I had a harder set. And I realized there was a yin-yang there, and that's more or less the dynamic that I've been seeking to kind of portray in some ways as – you don't have to leave. You don't have to leave your liberal label. You don't have to leave your conservative label. You can become a hyphenated transpartisan until you can really become someone who values, not just puts up with, but values the other points of view. And ultimately, I think that's what we're going to find out. We're going to have to do.
Thanks. So I guess you're very familiar with obviously very familiar with Bill Clinton and probably Tony Blair as well, and they, as you know, that they had the idea of what they called their third way, of bringing together traditional Democrats or traditional Labour Party voters, along with what the people that style themselves as progressives or liberals, postmodern Democrats or postmodern Labour Party people, and they tried to bring that together in the third way. Is that an example of transpartisan politics?
That's what I would call bipartisan. So our dualistic systems, which have spread more or less around the world, the us versus them systems, are essentially a divide and conquer strategy. So the Romans would call it DVD et imperium. Divide and conquer is a way of managing an empire. So if you want to build an empire, you essentially, as Machiavelli advised to de' Medici, that you essentially keep one group fighting against the other, and then the prince can maintain control. And that's more or less the system we inherited. It's actually, if you dig deeper into the roots of a republic, the republic res publica is based on this divide and conquer strategy. It's the way you can manage, and it's the way most empires have been managed. So when I see bipartisan strategies, I essentially look behind them and I say that these are agents, and I'm being very blunt here. Agents are not principals. Principals are owners. Agents act on behalf of owners. These are agents, essentially. We have the same thing happening in this country called no labels. And that's basically Republican insiders and Democrat insiders cooperating on behalf of essentially principals, which are people that stand behind our political system. And so, yes, when I see these, then I seek to create the distinction between a bipartisan evolution of our political system and a transpartisan, because transpartisan includes everybody, not just the insiders. It creates the conversation where the insiders and the outsiders can talk together as equals.
I read what you were saying, how through your experience you started off trying to bring together very senior leaders from, I think it was Congress, together, and were very successful in doing that. But you found that they had a lovely time and they related to each other. The hardest left opened to the hardest right, and it was a great success. But then they went back to their normal situation and carried on politics as normal. I saw that your conclusion that over time you moved to the idea of a grassroots transpartisan movement and basically growing it bottom up. Could you say a bit about Seattle, where you've been piloting that, and how successful has that been?
Well, all of this has been an experiment, and it's been humbling to admit that it's an experiment. I actually, early on, didn't want to say it was an experiment. I wanted to say we got the solution, we knew the answer, but obviously we don't, and I certainly don't. So yes, we began with getting leaders together, and then the vision was phase two was to get grassroots together, and phase three, which we haven't ever done, is leaders and grassroots. So there's a trajectory there. In other words, transpartisanship will not be achieved until you have the whole system speaking to itself with respect and openness. So having been frustrated with watching leaders go back to the old game, in Seattle we started a two-year process where we got left, right, center together in rooms, people that were as different as you get, Tea Party and Campaign for Liberty and Transition Seattle and the interfaith community, and dialogue. And we found the polarizing issues and we found the uniting issues, and we mapped them. And essentially what we came up with, and this came up through August and September of this past year, was what we're now seeing with the Occupy and Tea Party movements. Essentially, we're seeing a broad-level public reaction to consolidated power. Mm. And that's more – and we mapped our conversations. We did them on flip charts, and then we typed them into the computer, and so much of that is documented. We have all the documents, and we mapped a process where we could actually sit and listen to each other, and it was amazing that essentially the new polarity – now this is something we also anticipated 3 or 4 years ago – is the new polarity would be not a left-right polarity, it would be a top-down, it would be based on power. And that's really the one that traditionally needs to be reconciled. Otherwise, a society tends toward a revolution as opposed to an evolution.
Hmm. I went along to the Occupy Wall Street demonstration in London to interview the people there and find out what was motivating them, what was their positive vision. And I noticed that around the edge, there were quite a few business people and financial types actually coming in and being welcomed. And there was quite a healthy dialogue going on behind the scenes. But I put out the results of my interviews to the London Business School and to quite a big network of finance people. And I found that generally they weren't really interested to engage. And it struck me that the real power would come from not having two groups, the group of demonstrators and the group of people they're demonstrating against. But actually there's a real alchemy in people coming together. If you could take some of those people and their creative energies inside the banks, inside the financial institutions, that there might be something magical happen there. Do you have any insights on how to catalyze that?
Oh, Nicholas, given your background, this is a great bridge. The ability to bridge these worlds is extremely important, because the financial community would become very defensive. I mean, if I had demonstrators outside my office saying that I was abusing them and society, I would get a little defensive myself. And therefore, I probably would not want to engage. Or I would say, come onto my turf. here a handful of you come onto my turf where I feel safe. Again, it's the notion of safety, where I feel safe, and then we'll have a conversation. And then vice versa, or you all come out of your bank and come down to our, you know, public area and have a conversation. So what we've been really seeking to do is to create neutral spaces where it is truly safe for all points of view. This is like peace negotiation, because we're getting to the point of that sharpness of polarity here in the United States, where the Tea Party and the Occupy people are getting together and having conversations, and they're saying, we're seeing the exact same thing. And this becomes populism. Now, at that point, people within the higher ranks of society have the incentive to engage or suppress. And, you know, there's a part of me that I used to be on the side where I didn't like those hippies, and I didn't care about, you know, whatever I needed to do to cause them to go away, put them in jail, you know, whatever you needed to do to get them off the streets and out of the way and keep business as usual going. We're at an inflection point, it seems to me. Those strategies will not work. This is too broad scale. This is a global phenomenon, similar to the 1848 or so revolutions that spread. It was a field effect. It had a deeper – this is something that's happening at a scale that cannot be communicated away by PR firms, cannot be ignored in the same way. So that's what I'm seeking to do, is create the conversations where we can have alternative strategies, and essentially the dialogue strategy seems to me one of the most reasonable.
One of the fear is a big factor, isn't it, in the way that politics works, and emotional triggers that people have. And with so many massive transitions happening in world politics, in finance, and in all kinds of other areas, if people feel fearful of losing their job or of crime or of immigration or terrorism or whatever, that there can be a tendency to shut down and maybe polarize. What do you think is required to keep people or invite people into the creative space that you're talking about, even if they are feeling fearful or very angry with other groups or other opinions?
Well, okay, so this has been my personal journey. I was fearful, and I was extremely angry. I was extremely angry at the other side, and then I became very angry at the establishment. As I kind of saw behind the curtain of the way power really worked within national U.S. politics, and I saw the agency of and I saw who the principals were. I saw that the principals were essentially people that created money, and agents were people that kind of stood on the stage but actually didn't have any real power. I've met four presidents of the United States, and aside from George Bush Sr., I wouldn't say any of them were principals. These were not people that impressed me as like the source of power. They were agents of power, and that caused me to pay deeper attention to who power holders really were. And so, yeah, I had a lot of fear, a lot of anger, and that's why I've now come, after 8 years doing this work, the focus on the individual's responsibility. This, again, my conservative roots with the individual's responsibility to heal that. If I'm angry, nobody wants to talk to me.
Yeah.
They can feel it. If I'm fearful, then I won't even engage because I'm scared. I think that someone's going to, you know, hurt me. And so I have to go within myself to work on the roots of that. And then coming out of that, I call it the me, we, it. If I want to change the it, the big system, which all the Occupy people and the Tea Party people want to change the big system, we've got to start with me, then we go to we, then we go to it. And so the level of responsibility that I am now taking for healing my own wounds and my own insecurities and my own fears is that's really, to be honest, I'm 9 months into a deep path of withdrawing from the external engagements and doing a lot more internal work so that I can be prepared to do more of the external work.
Hmm. What sort of practices are you doing?
Well, I found what happened is I was sitting in these meetings, and as I said, in Seattle, 2 years, and there are a lot of reactionaries here. And I would get sucked into that reactivity, and I call them reactivists now, and we need something like a Activists Anonymous, truly. I'm very serious. And so that's kind of what we became, is we became this Activists Anonymous group where the activists from all sides were coming together and sharing their anger. Yeah. And doing the best they could to heal it. So what I did is I found that I needed to go between meetings. I began meditating. I began doing a technique that you and I share, of Vipassana, which is really just sitting and being quiet for a long time. And then I integrated that more and more into my life, and it's been very, very helpful. Actually, it's amazing that the Indian government, they send their government leaders to these meditations. And then and when they come back, then they have a deeper sense of calm and a deeper sense of the transient nature of life, and therefore less reactive. And to me, activists, if we can heal the reactivity on both sides, then ultimately you take the C in reactivity and move it to the front, and you get creativity. And so ultimately, that's one of the fruits. You get creative public policy. You get innovation as opposed to polarized reactivity.
Hmm. Yeah, I think in my own experience, I remember having quite a learning experience with having an argument with a Marxist professor, a very ultra politically correct, ultra sort of left-wing Marxist professor, and I'd gone to challenge him in his home ground, in his place, and he pulled all his sort of usual all the things, pulled his power, and was trying to undermine me with all sorts of social techniques. And when we eventually got into a debate, it was very much like a First World War battle, full force. We both hated each other, massive argument, and we both knew every contour of every trench because we'd had those arguments all the time. And in the end, I just sighed. I just realized I couldn't possibly win. And I kind of slumped, and I said, well, look, all right, if you could have all the things that you want in the world, if everything that you're saying politically happened, what kind of a world would that be? And he said, oh, that's easy, a world without racism. So I said, okay, what else? I said, I agree with you, what else? A world without sexism. Okay. And then he ran through all his anti-isms, and then but they were all the absence of something negative. And then finally, I said, well, what about positive? What positively would there be? He said, oh, a world of equality of opportunity. And I said, well, I agree with all of those, but what would the world be like if your political vision came true? And it was amazing. He like a windsock, without any wind, he just collapsed and just kind of sunk away. And this amazingly powerful figure that I'd not only hated, but ascribed all this power to, disappeared, and there was no one there. He softened and opened, and I realized that my job actually had been to leapfrog to the other side rather than trying to fight him, and to ask the question, what kind of a world would you like? The only problem was that in having spent all that time resisting him, I didn't know the answer to the question myself. And so that set me on a journey of asking the positive question of what kind of a world would I like?
Yes. No, that's actually what I've been saying but not doing, Nick, for so long. I've been saying that's where we need to be. And when I sat in these groups of reactionists, then I was so reactive. I could feel it within myself, all my judgment, all my pain, all my anger. then I couldn't get to the place of what world do we really like. And very often we would try to facilitate the groups in that direction. But if we had been wallowing in the pain for too long within the meeting, we never got to the positive vision of, okay, if you're in charge, if you're the mayor, if you're the president, what are you going to do? You know, because if you were the mayor or the president, you'd have to figure out how to deal with any situation. And so often the reactivist energy couldn't transcend the wounding. Now, my feeling is that through this process we're going through on the larger scale, enough of the unwounded are stepping forward where we will – and it's amazing. You know, it's like in a crisis or in a difficult situation, maturity kind of like – or leadership emerges. And this is a new version of leadership. This is like an ambient leadership that says, hey, what do we want? What is the version of the future that we want, that we all can align upon? And every time we went there, that's how we got the leaders. When we did these leadership retreats with major national leaders from all sides, where we aligned was where we wanted to go. We aligned on values. We aligned on vision. And so, yes, now, yeah, so it's a process to, it's in some ways a healing or an evolutionary process personally and then systemically to get there.
I heard you, to take that further, I heard you say that one of the questions that you ask of people is, the biggest, in your case, as Americans, you know, who are we and where are we going? I wonder if you could, if I put you on the spot, who are we and where are we going?
Oh, so the answer, and I'm speaking to you, and you're sitting in London, England, the capital of the country that we became independent from, theoretically, and. Yeah, at that time of our independence, we articulated very clearly, some very wise men that were, you know, former English subjects, articulated principles. One was unity. There is a unity among humanity. And that all faiths acknowledge. We're self-governing. In other words, we're responsible for creating our lives. We're free. In other words, we have free will. And these types of values were at the heart of the answer of who we were. It's almost like who you are as an individual. And then how do we codify that into documents like a constitution that says, that gives us an operating system? And right now we have a social contract that says we are children. And there are some parents in the world that are running things right now at the global level with a global financial system. And I at first was very shy about talking about the consolidation of global financial power, but now it's become so widely acknowledged that the Fed Reserve and the Bank of England and the Bank of International Settlements in Basel, Switzerland are essentially the parents of the world. And the people that attend those meetings and they do the governing, they're following a social contract. And the rest of the people in the world are sitting down on their butts on Wall Street complaining as children. And that's essentially who we are right now, is we're in this social contract that says we're children, we're all divided, and we're waiting for the parents to tell us what to do. So the vision that I have is the evolution of that res publica, which is the pyramid model where a handful of people at the top dictate to the rest, to an integration of a circle and a triangle, where you move from you bring in the emotional intelligence, you bring in the heart intelligence, and essentially that sounds soft and wishy-washy and a bunch of liberal talk, but conservatives have heart too. All soldiers have heart. All soldiers fight from the heart. Great sports people fight from the heart. It's called devotion. It's called courage, courage. I don't speak French, but it's the French word. So when you bring that quality into our systems, you don't get command and control. You don't get domination. You don't get abuse, whether it's from a banker in Switzerland or London or New York, or from whether it's a foreman on a construction crew that's abusing his power over four other Mexicans. What you get is you get hard intelligence. You get respect. Now, that banker in Basel, Switzerland, is well-educated and very sophisticated, and it has a lot of responsibility. But if they have heart, they're also going to realize, wow, I'm connected. I'm unified with the rest of humanity, and I really ought to consider the consequences of the vast power that I have over the decisions to defund, you know, something or to fund something. And when you factor that factor, you begin to change everything. And everything really, in some ways, it's the simplicity on the other side of complexity. Things become simple when you engage the head with the heart. And I could say more, but we're disengaged. We have systems that are heartless. And my feeling is through the coming or evolving crisis, this transformation, enough people will wake up to the practical, strategic use of hard intelligence that our systems will begin to shift towards more healthy. It won't be necessarily like the disintegration of everything we know, but it will be a transformation of a corporation or a court system or a government that functions in a healthier, more reasonable way.
Presumably, there are some examples of where this is working already, some seeds that are beginning to sprout.
Okay, well, that's a good question. So where do you see organizations that have hard intelligence? For example, Groupon is one of the fastest growing companies in the world. I think they started in 2008. They have 6,000 employees, and they have an award for organizational democracy. They operate in a circle triangle format. They have a CEO, and they have workers that are unskilled, and then they have extremely skilled professionals. But they have the circle process. It's almost like the quality circles that Ford Motor Company brought in, 30 years ago. They have the process within the organization to create the links of relationship. This is the lover energy that goes with the warrior energy within an organization. And when you and the lover represented by the circle and the warrior represented by the triangle, then the abuses of power don't happen because of the rankism, because of the disparity in rank. And Groupon is a great example. Another healthcare company, one of the Fortune 400 healthcare company, DaVita, same thing, just won an award for that type of internal culture. So these businesses that are finding that this is actually sustainable management it takes a little bit longer to make decisions because the triangle process, the pyramid process, is essentially wonderful in wartime and in emergency. If you're fighting a fire, you want the captain of the fire company to say, okay, get on your trucks, move out, do this, do that, don't talk back. And or if you're commanding an airplane and you're trying to land the airplane, you got to have one guy in charge. And believe me, I trust and respect that model as a former military officer. I didn't want my sergeant saying, well, sir, what are we going to, I don't know if I agree with what you're talking about here. So, but we're not in war or an emergency necessarily unless we create them, which unfortunately we've created these phony global terrorist wars to create the need for the pyramid process. But under alternative circumstances, when you engage people, then you engage then it takes longer to make decisions, but the quality of decisions are far higher.
I really like the simplicity of the triangle and the circle because, as you say, one of the cultural transitions is that we've gone from very traditional hierarchical societies where there's right and wrong, truth and falsehood, with always God or the Queen or an authority figure or parent at the top. And then as people have gone into postmodern liberalism, the world of, as you say, of heart, of multiple perspectives, of relativism, of sensitivity, of people sitting in a circle and sharing and so on. But one of the crucial flaws in that latter way of being is that so far people at that level of kind of values development have not been really good at organizing themselves. So they might exist in a particular group or a bunch of friends or in an academic department, but they're not very, those values alone without the traditional conservative ones are not very good at getting things done in a practical way or on a big scale. There's kind of a theme here of, for us to get to the next level, to get beyond those old divisions, we need to somehow integrate and hold things at multiple levels comfortable with paradox, don't we? So, for example, I wanted to ask you a question about, if you like, traditional conservatives would say, we want to be patriotic. We love our country. It's important to have strong borders, love our flag, support the military, etc., etc., and good, strong police, and so on. And then the more postmodern liberal end would say, oh, we don't need any of that anymore. That's all in the past. That led to wars. It leads to patriotism is racism. These borders are artificial. We should have global, diverse openness and so on. And how is it? And obviously, we know that left unchecked, that way of being is very dangerous. How do we actually comfortably sit with being global, genuinely global, fully open human beings who are equal and open to all other humans, aware of the fact that America, Britain, the Stars and Stripes, these things don't exist. They're just conscious things passing from moment to moment. Be really diverse, inclusive, multiracial, include all previously oppressed groups and so on, and be healthily patriotic. How is it possible to do all of that in a really conscious, healthy way?
Ooh, Nick, if I had the answer, then... sometimes admitting I don't know the answer is the way to have the answer to come. I don't know. I know within myself that patriotism has been my deepest, dearest value. And the love of my country, the love of this place, it truly has been a love. I was born in Marlboro, Massachusetts, which was on the route of Paul Revere, you know, and this is where our revolution started. And I walked the battlefields of the Civil War and I went to school in a school where we literally recited the names of the Civil War dead, you know, that had died over 100 years before me. So that connection with the heritage is real. The connection to place, I think everybody has that. I lived in Europe for a while, and people in Hungary, they have that deep connection to their place. Obviously, Britons do as well, and Indians, everybody does, Russians, Chinese. So it's the love of place is natural, and I don't think that's ever going to change. So how do you, in some ways, not lose that identity, but then be cooperative? You know, the United States and Canada did it. United States and Britain did it. It's because we have a common language and a common heritage. I think that there's, you know, now that the internet and the global communication, I think, is actually unifying people. It's probably unifying people in ways that we can't even imagine or can't even describe. Yeah, at some scale, maybe what we are trying to describe is that the heart is waking up, and I'm realizing that I am connected with people in India in ways that I didn't think I was, you know. And I visited India this year, and oh my God, it was such an amazing culture. It was so amazing to see. It was very dysfunctional from my Western standpoint, but the moment I slowed down and really watched, I saw so much that we were lacking here in the West. I saw so much peace, and I saw so much acceptance. And so kind of that East-West integration of the inner contemplative acceptance of the natural flow of life with the willpower and the direction and the desire to create and the strong value of the individual, maybe over time, as East and West, as Kipling says, East meets West and West meets East, and as these two come together, then maybe there is some sort of magical blend between the Buddhist and the Christian way of looking at things. And I, within myself, can certainly relate to both of those. That's probably not exactly responsive, but that's kind of where my mind went.
Well, one thing I was going to say is that to take an example, if you're I've read your Transpartisan Toolbox, how you do that, the process of getting people together and from huge range of different backgrounds, different political perspectives and so on, and how you basically draw them together in a really open-hearted, intelligent way. Now, obviously, as a psychiatrist, I get how you do that with one-to-one or how to do it with a small group in a room. But on a larger political scale, is there any way of doing that? So, for example, recently I had a conversation with a couple of people who you would say would be kind of postmodern liberal stroke left wing in their background, in their emotional attachments. And we were discussing the subject of benefits, welfare benefits for people who are sick. And obviously I'm a doctor and I've had years experience of dealing with people in that context. And I kind of pretty much matter-of-factly said that a very high percentage of those people who are receiving these benefits do so, some do it absolutely fraudulently, some do it because they're briefly not well and they never get back to work. And basically I was saying there's an awful lot of people that the system is carrying that it shouldn't be, and it's not in their interests, and it's not in the interests of the taxpayer and the health of society. Anyway, the punchline was that these two very rational, very intelligent, very open-hearted, very warm, conscious friends of mine completely went mad and got really, really aggressive and angry and just started shouting abuse about bankers and, well, what about rich bankers? What about their corruption of the system? What about our members of parliament and their, expenses and all this sort of thing? And they just wouldn't address the point. I said, well, all that's true and valid, but they just were emotionally so triggered and so incapable of addressing it. How do you deal with that? Can you deal with that?
So what I'm hearing really is the reactivity of these people against a system that they feel abused by, in some ways they feel victimized by. So there's a victim role, maybe a victim identity, and they're projecting the perpetrator identity onto the bankers. And I've been the perpetrator, I've been that on the side of the perpetrator very often in personal relationships and also kind of in politics, coming from the side that tended to be accused of being mean and cold-hearted. So how do you mediate a victim-perpetrator dynamic is really the question I'm hearing. Is how do you transcend that? There's a great book called the TED, the Empowerment Dynamic, and it's transcending. It's moving from the victim role to the creator role, moving from the perpetrator role to the challenger role. So then the creator and the challenger are in a dynamic tension. They're in a creative tension. The banker and the welfare recipient are in a dynamic tension in a empowered triangle. Now, who's the third person in the triangle? It's generally a mediator, or what would be called, Bill Urey in his book, The Third Side, call it, it's a third side. It's a safe space to allow that conversation. And we've created spaces where literally we couldn't look each other in the eye. I saw there were perpetrators that were so ashamed of their perpetration and victims so triggered by their victimhood, they couldn't look each other in the eye. But we had enough other people sitting there, and these are, I'm thinking right now of leaders right now, and over time, through a process of personal stories, value sharing, going into the conflict, courageously going into the conflict, and then going to policy, personal stories, values, politics, policy, that victim and that perpetrator ended up looking each other in the eye. And they saw each other because they heard their personal story. They observed the humanity in the other person. And so if you and I and others like us, Nick, can create spaces where the banker can sit with this person and discharge that charge that's there, because the perpetrator ultimately, as you well know, as a doctor, that you know that it's the feels like a victim in some ways, and the victim ends up being a perpetrator. It's just a different, it's a passive aggression versus an active aggression. So yes. At any rate, yes, then ultimately, how do you diffuse that in Northern Ireland? I think a lot of people found processes. They worked on the peace process to get the third side circle with the Protestant and the Catholic, and it's worked.
Great. What, one last question is, I'm just reading from a quote that I think you said, disintegration gives us the opportunity for something new, meaning that you were observing that many of the old structures of our societies are not really working and falling apart. What might that something new be?
So it's the analogous to the caterpillar and the butterfly, which I'm sure you've heard. It's the caterpillar has to disintegrate, almost literally. The cells go back to some sort of little soup in that chrysalis before the butterfly emerges. So in this period of the chrysalis, where our old institutions are beginning to disintegrate because their inability to deal with complexity, they're an operating system that is like an old IBM 286 trying to run a society that takes Windows XP or something. You know, we need an upgrade of the operating system in command and control, patriarchal, res publica, republics will not get us there, and we're finding that out. So what is the butterfly? It is, to me, the circle triangle. Franca Baroni, in her book on governance, calls it core publicum. Core publicum is the evolution of res publica. It's the public heart. And the moment we engage courageously, from the conservative standpoint, screw the word compassion. Conservatives can't hear it. But they can hear the word courage. And I feel that literally in one side of my heart. Compassion is the other side of my heart. Core publicum actually is the manifestation of institutions, banks, governments, libraries, academia, corporations, every institution that brings heart wisdom into it begins to, that to me is the butterfly. Then everyone is served. Everyone wins. And then there are the victims become creators and the perpetrators become simply challengers. And then you have the creative upward spiral as opposed to the downward spiral that we're currently experiencing.
That's fantastic. Really inspiring. I did say finally, but finally, the reason I invited you to chat really was about exploring the future of Western civilization. Is there any, that's a very big subject, but is there anything that you would have liked to have said that you haven't done?
Well, to me, so I identify as a member of Western civilization, and more I feel that the Eastern and the Western are informing each other. Literally, in our business cultures, we're integrating between the Eastern and the Western cultures. Think of all the airplanes that are traveling between India and China and Europe and America, cross-pollinating all of these different cultures and these ways of looking at the world. Literally, the brain development in the East is different than the brain in the West because we're so focused on language and analysis. But in the East, it's much more, you know, it's a different way. It's a Taoist brain. In other words, the ability to integrate polarities is different. And so, yeah, maybe the future of Western civilization is something that I would like it to be in the direction of integration of the circle and the triangle. And to me, that's what I would call a democratic republic. And that to me is a sustainable form of governance. And we have had 8,000 or so years of a certain model that now is disintegrating into a new model. And yeah, it's the golden age. I mean, not to get too utopian, but there is true yearning for the releasing of creative intelligence on this planet and invention and innovation in this to make life for everybody happy. And you and I share that notion of just be happy and releasing the bonds that we have placed on each other and allow ourselves to be happy. And it's almost as simple as a organizing model that could be that I try to boil down to a circle and a triangle. And yes,
fantastic. Thank you so much, Joseph. It's been a huge enormous pleasure talking to you. If anyone listening over in America would like to get in touch or to participate in your Transpartisan Alliance, how would they do that?
Transpartisan.net is the website, but really where we are is we're simply, I have been more of a consultant and an advisor. What's happening? There are many people doing what I'm talking about, many different, and so Coffee Party USA is one group that's doing it. No Labels is a version that's doing kind of a bipartisan approach. The Liberty Coalition in Washington, D.C. is another one, liberty.net or libertycoalition.net, coffeepartyusa.org. And, yeah, I would just say it's really doing the personal work, not necessarily joining an organization, because I realize that we're really seeking to catalyze a movement of movements that thinks in a different way.
Great. Thank you, Joseph.
Yeah, thank you, Nick.